Okay, testing once again. Hello, 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 hello. Okay. Now, to what I was really going to do. No, that's not it. That's it. Had this idea in my head for this Chow Warrior. And, wasn't what I wanted to do. Wanted to show you guys. I'm just looking up chow puppies on Pinterest. So I've got that in my other monitor. Yeah. I'm gonna try drawing some chow guys. I was having trouble getting close enough to my desk. Something I noticed about Chow Chows is that they got kind of squinty eyes. This isn't necessarily universal, but it's definitely true with my dogs, and it seems to be a pretty common thing. So if we're going to humanize Chow Chows, I think the best thing to do is kind of exaggerate that a bit. If you ever want to make like a really cute kid chow chow kid, or like just a, or just like a puppy chow chow. Chow chows are always stay kind of stumpy, but when they're itty bitty, they're even cuter and stumpier. So. so I'm gonna run this doodle stream for like an hour, maybe two. Just kind of some morning thing to do. And like, tell your friends. Hopefully, we can get like some company. But right now, I'm still kind of trying to work out my format. Like, I would have done some electro. I would have maybe put like an electro swing weighted radio station on if I hadn't needed so long just to troubleshoot. And I'm still troubleshooting because this mic just will not stay in a position. Like, it just keeps swinging. Which, nothing should be swinging unless you're swinging to an electro swing. Like, it just shouldn't. That's not right. You should only swing when you're supposed to. And not when you're an inanimate object. Another thing is that if you're gonna draw a chow person, you have to figure out a way to integrate all that fuzz. Because chows are especially fluffy, so, like, how does that spread over onto the shoulders and that sort of thing? Like, I don't really normally draw a lot of fuzzy people, but I notice that when I observe kind of that sort of art. The most effective ones seem to be when you're actively including stuff like the fur into the piece. Totally forgot. So that's an idea. Let's work. I think we gotta thumbnail a few poses. I realize the furry community like really likes their more like realistic-y, semi-realistic, human-esque designs, but I don't know. I really like cute animal people. I'm not super big on the hyper-realism. Well, not hyper-realism, you know, semi-realism. See if anyone said anything. Nope. I think this would be fairly easy to come up with, but I don't think anyone's actually thought of it yet. Detective Chow. I'm going like full on Sherlock Holmes with this take. Well, roughly. I have to actually look up something like a great coat to get it right, but it's an idea. not like this idea. Boxer Chow. I don't know. Pirate Chow just to me looks like a raccoon, so maybe not that. I kind of like this idea, so I think maybe I'll develop that. And call this super rough, because man, I have so much to adjust. Okay. There we go. There we go. So almost a ghost of the original line. I'm gonna save what I've done up to this point. Man, I've done a lot this time. think I gotta get back to my chow dogs here. Yeah, I didn't think I'd be going for this, but I think overall the hands are gonna be pretty human. I'm having a hard time figuring out is how exactly do I want to integrate the fluff. I think I'm onto something with that. It's a little stripped out now, but it'll make subsequent layers a little bit easier to subsequent rough layers a little bit easier to handle. All right, I'm gonna take a split second break. Okay. 45 minutes left. I don't know if I'm going to be able to bring it to the point of inking in that time, but I can at the very least. Get it ink worthy, I think. technically this streak of magical light is going to be rendered on its own layer once I get around to finishing this guy, but I like just having it there in the rough so I know that what's going on. Sorry for all the frequent pausing, folks. I'm sort of looking at employment, like during the school year employment stuff. This semester is going to be very busy and also very expensive, so I have to kind of figure out some way to cover all this stuff. So. Even though I worked a job over the summer, it was minimum wage, so I couldn't cover everything. I've been able to cover some stuff with it, but not everything, so I have to look at more work. Pretty much, I'm just gonna turn into a total hermit workaholic this semester. I don't really have a choice. Whatever I do, it's gonna be a lot of work. Where are you, chow dogs? There we go. I kind of want to have him smirking. He's a cool magician guy. He can smirk. Here we go. Doing it there. Yeah, another thing I discovered was that nice lady actually was not wearing any shoes. And I think it would tie the design up a little bit better if I didn't have any shoes on this guy. So I'm going to remove the shoes, and I'm going to give him these little chow paw-like feet. Because again, I like my cuteness. I don't feel like I should go 100% humanoid with this, because that seems to be... I don't know, it doesn't entirely defeat the purpose of anthropomorphizing something like this, but to me, it kind of sheds a lot of opportunities. If you're gonna make, like, an animal person, then you gotta exaggerate something. In my case, I'm kind of coming up with this idea for, like, to be honest, I think it would go, I think this character would fit in really well in, like, a good Hong Kong action movie, you know? Like, especially, like, a slightly comedic one. You know, you got all these pets as great martial art heroes. That'd be kind of cool, like a wushu fantasy with talking animal people. I think if you put enough effort into the animation, you could really sell it. And, like, even with a comedy, like, always put the effort in. Like, the reason why stuff like Stuart Little worked is because, like, sure, it was comedic, but it was also... They also put a lot of work into it, and you could really see the effort. I really gotta turn the notifications off on that phone. I think this is pretty much roughed. I mean, at least the character is. Although, I'm gonna do one thing to make his characterness a little bit more obvious. I realize this is kind of stereotypical, but I want it to read really well, so... There we go. Hehe. Looks like a little video game character. Really probably consider putting in more yay. Did I not put any of you in there? Should really start coding in more hotkeys to Clip Studio. I hotkeyed the heck out of Photoshop and I definitely didn't regret it. But I don't have all those hotkeys built into Clip Studio yet, and I'm starting to wonder if maybe I've made an error in that regard. I think, to be honest, I need something a bit softer. This guy definitely says Even that India ink sable brush is a bit. So let's see what I can do with some oil paints. I'm pretty much just gonna keep messing around with the presets until I get something I like. Nope. Kinda like the feel of that. Actually, feels really nice to be able to like really capture the texture of a character in the brushwork. I so often think about just making the smoothest line, or in the case of Homeworld, the most textured line possible. That like in Homeworld, my line work is like not quite UPA thick, or rather, or if it makes sense to you, I guess Cartoon Network. Like kind of 2000s, like Dexter's Lab sort of thick. Like, don't get me wrong, it's really good line work, but I find that when you go quite that thick, you lose quite a bit of expressiveness in the mix. So I don't generally go that thick myself, but I can kind of see the appeal. But Homeworld's kind of like as thick as I can get while still having stuff like contours and things like that, so I can kind of get a bit of that Adventure Timey, like, thing going on. Like I've got fairly loose forms in Homeworld, whereas here I'm trying to keep my forms a little bit more defined. one mixed bag about this character is that a lot of the lines are not going to be completely closed off, which might make flatting things a bit trickier. Reminds me, what have people been saying? I haven't been in checking the Twitch, like, at all. If you're barely hearing, it's probably not just you. I moved the mic far away and I didn't think to compensate for it, so I'm gonna try turning it up. Okay, is that better? Yeah, I've been commentating the whole time. I mean, I guess time will tell. Like, I won't know how this has turned out until the recording's finished, and I can go in and convert it, because I can't even play FLVs on the computer itself. I have to convert it into, like, an MP4 before I can even play it, so it's the worst. But it is what it is. Now, out of respect to the fact that this Chao character has kind of stumpy feet, I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make his handy paws a little bit thicker. Paw hands. Because it seems kind of justified, and that'll help make the design a bit more consistent. I'll probably do the more slender, human-like hands in a later design for somebody else. Probably not a Chow Chow. Kind of like the idea of having cuffs, or maybe even. Bandages. Now, I think for the evening stream, it'd be a good idea for me to do some fan art of some sort. Something I've been thinking about doing is, when I started playing Ocarina of Time, I did these, like, kind of irreverent journal entries about just kind of what Link had been up to. And I think maybe I want to turn that into a mini-comic of some sort. I think that might potentially be quite a lot of fun. And, yeah, what do you guys think about that? Like, I'm pretty much inking at this point, so I'm not really looking at the reference quite as much anymore. I'm very much focused on my own line work. So I got time to just discuss these things. This particular rotating the canvas trick I actually learned in animation school. And I've done it ever since. It is so useful for making like actually fairly clean lines. Not convinced I'm one of those people who's gonna have like the most perfect ultra clean line art out there, but I feel awfully good about the direction my line art is going. Like, just in general, like, my Homeworld stuff has slowly cleaned up quite spectacularly over the last year or so. And this seems to be turning out reasonably well as well, in terms of line art. Which is good, because I used to hate doing line art, like, so much. Like, so much, you guys. Like, so much. You don't. I'm sure you do know, but I used to hate it. It was terrible. It was like the most tedious thing ever, and like when I was done with it, it looked bad, and I was like, why do I have to even do line art? I just don't. Insert more made up swear words here, and yeah, I wasn't a big fan. Now I feel quite a bit better about it. Which I guess is a very important place to be, really, as an artist, because at some point you're gonna have to do some polished work. And you can't just paint all the time, especially if you're gonna be in animation. You have to actually lean quite a bit more on your line art. What I'm trying to figure out is how exactly I want to. Like, do I even want to do webbing between the toes? I kind of do, but I don't know if that's. You have some. Just some fuzz poking out there. No, that might work, actually. Yeah, it looks pretty adorbs. So I'm gonna stick with fuzz. Another tip that my animation school gave me, which I'm admittedly taking with a bit of a grain of salt here. Is always know exactly where you want to place your line before you start inking it. That's why I did all those many passes in the rough stage, because I wanted to make sure that I at least had a good idea of where I wanted to place my line. I don't necess If I'm not getting paid by the industry, like if I'm just getting paid by, like, say, printing this out and selling it at cons, which realistically is what's probably gonna happen here, I just do not have the time to do like multiple passes, not only on the roughs, but also on the inks. Like they had us doing at least two passes on the inks to get like the line work just perfect. And to be honest, when you're getting paid industry money, that's an extremely justified thing to do because like your work is A, showing up on TV, and B, you're not exactly going to lose anything from putting in the extra time. You're on the clock to deliver very high quality work, and you can afford to do that. But when you're on your own time and you have to just get work out to people, you don't necessarily have time for quite that level of perfectionism, which is the one thing that kind of saddens me about being pure indie is that I can't do. No matter how hard I try, I'm not gonna get quite. I can't spend quite as much time going super fancy with line art At least not yet. I mean, there are some ultra popular artists that can pull that off, but I'm not one of them, so I kind of have to work with what I've got. The other slightly good thing about doing it this way is that when you're not doing a zillion passes on inks and stuff like that, you still have time for a little bit of spontaneity. The artwork that you see in the animation industry is ultra polished, but maybe sometimes you notice that, like, maybe it looks a little overly refined. Like, maybe they gave it one pass too many, and now like Dora's face looks kind of dead, sort of thing. That's something that can sometimes crop up. And one good thing about not having the time to do 8 billion different passes on it is that you can still have a bit of humanity in your work, which is kind of the really nice thing about indie. It's like, on the one hand, stuff you find on the independent level is not going to be quite as polished as something you see made by a big studio, but I'm not getting that particular line. But what you do get is very, very relatable, very human stuff. Like, especially when you're just at the little cons and on the local circuits, where people are just, like, they're literally just handing you Xerox copies of stories about, like, what it's like to be a budgie, which is a mini comic that I got at Canzine West, I think, like, a year and a half ago, and I totally forgot about. And then I just read it again the other day while I was cleaning on my desk, and it's actually pretty human little comic. You know, you find yourself suddenly relating to this budgie. And, like, that wasn't something that you can really get in the mainstream. Like, you don't get quite that kind of thing in mainstream comics. Like, you don't feel what it's like to live in a birdcage in mainstream stuff. It's just not something that the AAA people are interested in exploring, so there are distinct advantages to doing things both ways. And, like, this summer, I actually wasn't paid industry money, but I was on the hourly. I was getting paid, like, minimum wage, but it was still nice and consistent. It's easier than, it's a more It's still a somewhat more solid wage than what you can get working indie for the most part. And I put in, like, the hours into getting, like especially the characters that we put on some of our promotional material. I put the extra time in to get those people, like, right. Because I wanted to make my portfolio look good, but more importantly, B, I wanted to kind of make this nonprofit organization look like a AAA business place as much as I could. Because, to be honest, when a organization does good work, regardless of what level they're at, I think that they should be able to look like they're just as important as the big boys, because objectively speaking, they are. And society tends to forget that because maybe they don't always have the most shiny PR. But I kind of did my bit to maybe correct that a little bit this summer, which I feel awfully good about, even if I do have a bit more work to do. So, like, I don't regret what I did this summer by any means. Also, the workplace I was in was, like, one of the best, like, ever for me. Like, I've done a lot of retail gigs and stuff, so, like, this working at this place after all that was absolutely amazing, and I don't mind telling you folks that. So, like, these folks, like, were really, really passionate about their community, and they were like, kind of just sweet people to talk to in general. Like, you could hang out with them at lunch And they would happily hang out with you, and you can talk all sorts of things, and some of them would watch The Office, and it was really cool. One thing I'm trying to figure out is, like, how exactly do I want I mean, I guess logically the and I guess logically the stuff like the flesh should be somewhat obscured by the fur. But like how much really? Like maybe you can do like a subtle fuzz pattern for to represent knuckles, 'cause I really still really want to get those knuckles in. Like I really like that kind of dimensionality in my hands. Even though I have so much to learn about hands, and I readily admit that, I really want to get a little bit of dimensionality in them hands. What do we think? I think that's something. No, that's starting to mess with it. Yeah, see, it's actually genuinely hard in places to like integrate fuzziness with humanness. Because there's so many bony forms on a human, and like especially something as fuzzy as a chow chow's is by comparison very, very kind of soft. Like there's angles to be found on a chow chow. I know because I hang out with chow chows, but they're not as prevalent. They're kind of covered up by all the fuzz. So I'm figuring out here, maybe where I guess the bandages are kind of a good way to cover it up a bit, but I think maybe I should consider putting a bit more time into tackling that particular problem. Like where to get your fuzzy business in, where to get your I think different anthro people have different ways of solving this one. And I'm so used to drawing just people that I'm not really used to approaching it, but it's really something I should tackle a bit more, just professionally. Like where now, since I established the fuzzy knuckles on the other hand, I'm gonna do them here as well. Because they're just too good to not have. I think the fuzzy knuckles were a really good idea there. So that's an idea I think works. I think kind of the fuzz between the webbing also kind of works, but oh. Okay. Well, the relative finger thickness seems to be about right, so. And this hand's a bit more tilted away, so I'm just gonna make it quite clear that it's tilted away. 'Cause yeah, this hand almost looks smaller than this hand, but they're really the same size. It's mostly just a difference in angle. Yeah, okay. Alright, I think I'm onto something with that. And okay. So I am going to lock the inks layer because that's about as good as I'm gonna get at that particular moment in time. And what I'm gonna go ahead and do is actually, better yet, whenever I do special effects, I always do it on a separate layer, and I usually do it on top of inks, 'cause then you can show your glowiness. Like on top of all the of all your line work, and it kind of reflects it a little bit, and I really love playing with that, so I kind of wanna have the one bad habit that Clip Studio always does, which does frustrate me a bit, is it always has its folder setting default to just kind of being normal. And what frustrates me about that, and this is kind of an oddly specific complaint, admittedly, is when I do stuff like special effects, I kind of want it to, whatever I assign it to be the look. I don't want it to be just set to normal. Usually, especially when I'm doing like special effects, I want the setting to be more like, what the heck is it? Screen. And what screen does is it, if for those of you who don't use Photoshop, what screen does is it allows you to make the color on top a much lighter. It's transparent, but at the same time, it's also lighter than what you have underneath it because it basically takes what you have underneath it and it goes, okay, I'm going to lighten it by this calculated amount and the color on top and the color on underneath will still show up, but it'll be much, much lighter. Which means that your special effects basically get to interact with the surrounding. Oh yeah, I didn't even set the screen. Derp derp. There we go. Get to basically interact with the surrounding line work. Or color work once I get to that. Which I think admittedly I might have to do out of stream because I've spent a long time just researching this little dude. But let's try this out with the special effects sort of thing. So SFX fill 1. I'm going to use my watercolor brush because it'd be so perf with this, and I'm going to go ahead and brush in some effects here. Even have a little bit of glow like on the side, a little subtle sparks. Like when you're doing something like a fiery effect, like especially in something like watercolor, like keep your line work in mind. Like of course you don't want to lose the plot with that, but like have a little fun with it. Like don't make it something that you're gonna. Make it something that you have fun with. Cause like the harder work stuff is already. There we go. So I've now set that to screen, and it's subtly lightening the line work underneath it. I'm also going to set this to screen going in so you get to see exactly what it does. So as you can see, it simultaneously kind of pulls out and lightens the color underneath it. Which I think is very, very cool. If I were to set it normal, it wouldn't have quite that same glowy effect. See? Like it's still there. It still definitely exists, but it doesn't pull. It's just kind of its own color. It's overlaying it. It's not really accounting for the color underneath it. Whereas if you turn on screen, it accounts for color underneath it, pulls it out, and lightens it, in addition to itself. So it becomes that little bit more effective. I'm gonna do one more layer of these fills, and then I think I'm gonna call it. In this case, I want to make this one quite light. Not totally white or anything like that. I still want to have some real color to it, but I definitely want to make this stuff really, really light at this point. Think I might have overdone it there. Okay. Cause I don't wanna blast like the color out completely. Alright, why don't I turn my paper back on?
See, here's the other funny thing about screen, and that's part of the reason why I had the transparency on the whole time, is if you have screen on top of a layer like white, it pulls out and lightens the color underneath it. White is already as light as you can get. You cannot get lighter than white. So when you screen on top of white, it just doesn't show up. You don't have anything. It's like, ooh, you have like, yeah, I see you have some light on your thumb. And like that's it. It doesn't really know what to do with a white background. It's like, well, you can't go any lighter than this. But I think for this character, I definitely want to give him a background of some sort. And I'm not gonna trace it here. I'm definitely going to give him. I'm definitely gonna draw in a background for him. The question is that what should I draw? And B, how am I going to impromptuly make it fit into this little scene? I might even possibly pick this up again tonight and maybe have this Chow character all filled out so that when we come back, in the event that you do want to come back, we can just kinda walk through a background together, and that could be a lot of fun. So, yeah, thank you so much for being at this morning's stream, or for retroactively just watching it. I am going to turn this guy off for now, and I'm planning on starting this back up tonight at 5 p.m. It's gonna run for like another couple hours, maybe three if I'm lucky to get that kind of time, but I'm probably gonna go with just the two. And yeah, I definitely look forward to seeing you then. So, ciao for now, or ciao ciao, and I will see you later tonight. Thank you so much.